CATL is a huge part in the EV revolution in China, and it's important to understand their relationship with Tesla in depth.
As Americans, it's really easy for us to overlook the details of what's happening in China. However, what's happening there is arguably more important for Tesla's future growth prospects than what's happening here in the States. Did you know that to date, CATL has only manufactured prismatic cells?
Did you know that CATL has a company-run dating service that took credit for 52 marriages last year?
Or how about that CATL is the supplier for your iPhone and your MacBook? Or did you know that CATL may also be setting up to supply Tesla with cells at Giga Berlin in addition to Giga Shanghai? In this episode, we'll give you all of the information you need to understand the Tesla and CATL relationship in depth, and we'll give you some fun facts for use at dinner parties and such. CATL, or Contemporary Amperex Technology Limited, was founded in 2011 by Zhang Yuquan. Because I'm certain I'm pronouncing that wrong, we'll stick with his Western name, Robin Zhang. CATL grew rapidly with the help of government policies and a de facto ban on foreign companies selling batteries in China. On the back of Chinese subsidies, CATL developed into a dominant battery supplier, and by 2017, they took the world number one spot for the first time, unseating LG Chem and Samsung SDI.
Zhang actually worked on lithium-ion batteries for consumer electronics for most of his career.
While president of just Amperex Technologies, the consumer electronic battery division, Zhang took a huge gamble on the direction of Chinese policy moving forward. In 2011, there were only 1,000 alternative energy vehicles sold in China. However, Zhang decided to spin off CATL from ATL with the hope that the future of lithium-ion batteries for the EV market would expand. And expand it did, as government subsidies for the NEV, or New Energy Vehicle market, reached $12 billion by 2016 and 17. CATL also benefits from an aggressive Chinese policy where the government acquires lithium, nickel, and rare earths and provides these minerals to the battery manufacturers. These Chinese mining companies are responsible for 62% of the global supply of cobalt. Earlier this year, in February, Tesla and CATL signed a two-year deal in which CATL will provide Tesla with batteries at Giga Shanghai. The contract is set to run through 2022, but it's a non-binding production pricing agreement, which means it's unclear how many batteries Tesla will actually buy from CATL. And one could argue this contract is experimental in nature, as it's rumored that this deal with CATL is significantly smaller than the deal Tesla has in place with LG Chem at Giga Shanghai.
CATL will be making LFP batteries without cobalt for Tesla vehicles in Shanghai. They should eventually supply batteries for half the Shanghai plant output.
If you're not familiar, LFP stands for lithium iron phosphate. These batteries are set to be anywhere from 10 to 20% cheaper than the NCA and NCM chemistries that Tesla has used to date. This could result in Tesla's cost per car falling from $600 to $1,200 per unit. And yes, LFP technology is less energy dense, but one thing not enough people are talking about CATL is their cell-to-pack technology. CATL has claimed this cell-to-pack tech can increase energy density by 10 to 15% and improve volume utilization by 15 to 20%. In total, it can reduce the parts needed for the battery packs by 40%. And guess who else is moving towards cell-to-pack? You got it, Tesla. At Elon's interview with Third Row, he explained how the four-module system being used in the Model 3 is not necessary, as the modules are not actually interchangeable. He said, quote, "The original reason why the Roadster pack had like 16 blades or modules was that if one of them didn't work, you could pull it out and put another in. The modules in the Model 3 are not actually interchangeable, so there's no point in having modules really. We should just have a pack," end quote. Every Model S and X built today are actually capable of swapping a battery pack, but there are no stations to perform this task.
Tesla does actually have a patent application for this cell-to-pack technology.
The patent describes a new approach where battery pack parallel subgroups are made integral to the cells themselves. This is contrary to the old way where single battery cells come from the battery manufacturers and are then placed into modules separately. The cell manufacturing plants would become battery submodule plants. What comes out of the plant will look like this. A CATL cell-to-pack battery can increase system energy density from 180 watt-hours per kilogram to more than 200 watt-hours per kilogram. And at the cell level, the energy density has reached 240 watt-hours per kilogram, and by 2024, CATL aims to increase their energy densities to 350 watt-hours per kilogram.
With Tesla and CATL working on this cell-to-pack technology, there's a chance they work together to further improve this.
CATL is also right now building a factory in Germany, and we know that Tesla will also be there. The factory is set to be one of the largest in Europe, both in terms of size and production capability. It's assumed that this plant is going to be predominantly to help feed BMW. CATL is definitely committed to expanding outside of China, as to date, almost 90% of their revenue has come from China. If Tesla and CATL can make this partnership work, there is huge opportunity for global expansion with this model, as no one else outside of China is using this low-cost LFP technology in a pure electric vehicle. In a recent interview, Zhang said, quote, "We won't exclude the possibility to supply Tesla's Berlin Gigafactory," end quote. Elon and Zhang have become friends, and they apparently exchange text messages often. They discuss innovations in their overlapping technology, responses to the current global issues, and of course, cheaper batteries and vehicles. I really liked what Zhang said about Elon recently, saying, quote, "Elon talks about cost all day long, and I told him to be assured that I would have solutions. We get along well. He's a fun guy," end quote.
CATL is the perfect fit to drive down cost. They have spent a lot of time and energy on research and development.
CATL spending on R&D jumped about 50% last year. They have 5,400 employees focused on research, making up over one-fifth of their 24,000-person staff. They recently broke ground on a new lithium-ion battery lab called the 21C Lab at its headquarters in Ningdi. The $466 million investment is scheduled to be in operation at the end of 2021, and it will be focused on metalithium batteries, solid-state batteries, and sodium-ion batteries. CATL spent $96 million on research during the first half of last year alone, which was about 11% of revenue. BYD, China's largest NEV maker, spent 6% of revenue on their R&D for context. John B. Goodenough even sent a congratulatory letter on the 21C project.
As mentioned earlier, CATL has focused mostly on prismatic-style battery cells.
Earlier this year, it was reported that Tesla was set to deviate for the first time from their cylindrical cells, which they've used exclusively to date. They are set to be moving to the prismatic LFP tech in the standard range Model 3 at Giga Shanghai. As mentioned, this is shaping up like a big experiment. If Tesla can use CATL's new prismatic cells with new LFP, cobalt-free chemistry, with new cell-to-pack technology, and do so in a way that maintains manufacturing efficiency, this could open up the floodgates to replicate this model in Giga Berlin and at all future sites, where Tesla will make a standard range, low-cost Model 3. So while the Tesla and CATL deal may be short in nature and uncertain in value, the potential is seemingly there for a huge deal moving forward if things break right. In addition to eliminating the most expensive raw material, cobalt, CATL also wants to eliminate other costly metals such as nickel and manganese. This is another step for Tesla to localize its supply chain in Shanghai. However, one of the most overlooked aspects of this relationship is what it means for Tesla and the Chinese government. Working with a domestic supplier like CATL will further improve their relationship with the Chinese authorities. Zhang actually serves on the Chinese People's Political Consultative Conference, the advisory body to top Chinese officials. This cannot be overstated, as China has ambitions to dominate the global EV market in both battery and vehicle technology. They have one of the most supportive governments in the world and have been committed to Tesla's success. Tesla giving back to the government by employing a local battery supplier will continue to strengthen that relationship and open up more opportunities for Tesla to grab market share in China.
And it wouldn't be a CATL video without mentioning their 1 million mile battery.
And I love Tesla, but honestly, even I'm getting a little bit sick of continually hearing about this 1 million mile battery. However, I wanted to point out again that CATL does apparently have its own in-house 1.2 million mile battery that will only cost 10% more and is apparently ready to be sold. So yes, this is completely separate from Tesla's 1 million mile battery.
It needs to be mentioned that the Chinese NEV market has been in free-for-all this year.
Battery sales fell almost 35% in the first 5 months of 2020, according to SNE Research. Car purchases plunged in China amid the pandemic, trade war, and scaling back of government subsidies. EV car sales have declined about 38% from just 1 year ago. Tesla cut the price of its Made in China Model 3 standard range to less than $42,000 in order to meet eligibility requirements of China's NEV subsidies. In April, China announced that it will extend subsidies for NEVs for 2 years, but they will only apply to passenger cars that cost less than $42,000. It will be very important to watch the sales and production data out of Giga Shanghai in the second half of 2020. I do, of course, think Giga Shanghai will continue to rebound as we saw from the Q2 data. I think that the demand for Tesla will also continue to outpace demand for the greater EV market. So while the overall EV market in China may indeed continue to struggle with less government support, I still see a viable path for Tesla to gain new market share and to continue to expand rapidly. Even Zhang himself has expressed doubt about what will happen when the Chinese government subsidies go away. He even said to his employees, "Can pigs lifted by a typhoon really fly?" And as always, guys, let us know what you think about Tesla and CATL and what it means for the future. And in case you missed them, you can check out this episode about the new up-and-comer in the EV space, Hylion, or you can check out this one about a potential Tesla stock split. Thank you guys for watching. I'll see you in the next episode.